welcome to Good News Week. And the big news? Australia's richest man, Kerry Packer, became even richer this week when he picked up $6 million by backing Might and Power in the Melbourne Cup. Apparently, Kerry had a few words with the horse before the race. He told him if he didn't win, he'd wake up with a jockey's head in his bed. The Prime Minister scrapped upfront nursing home fees this week, declaring he'd made a mistake. The government was desperate to defuse the pensioner protest. I mean, they move so slowly, a march would tie up traffic for months. John Howard decided on the fee backflip when he realised pensioners still retain certain assets. Votes. And speaking of mea culpa, Chinese President Jiang Zemin told the world that the 1989 Tiananmen Square massacre may have been a mistake. Previously, Tiananmen Square didn't rate a mention in Chinese history books, but now it's covered by the word oops. The old explanation was that when Deng Xiaoping heard about the protesters, he told the head of the People's Army to send them our thanks, but was misunderstood because of his cheap false teeth. Reconciliation took a step forward this week. Aboriginal leaders became reconciled to the fact they can't talk to the present government. The coalition refuses to budge an inch on their WIC legislation. They figure if they stay put long enough, they'll be able to claim native title over it. Mr. Howard, of course, says he's all for reconciliation. He just doesn't see the need to involve Aborigines in the process. The new Prime Minister of New Zealand is a woman. Tragically, she is still a New Zealander. Now, Jim Bolger, the previous New Zealand Prime Minister, was replaced in a coup while he was out of the country at a conference. I thought that only happened in backward third world countries. The news came as such a shock to Deputy Prime Minister Winston Peters. He announced he was going down the pub. When he was told he was already down the pub, he thumped the reporter for asking trick questions. Cheryl Curnow, who used to be a cricket umpire, is the new patron of women's cricket in Australia. Cricket is a game where two people play bat and ball while everyone else stands around doing bugger all, just like backbenchers. And a cricket umpire is someone who stands around all day and occasionally holds up one finger. In politics, this is called interjecting. But the women cricketers are suspicious of Cheryl as an umpire. She may claim to be neutral, but you know she's going to leap up and take a catch for one of the teams eventually. Prince Charles, Prince Harry and Nelson Mandela had a special thrill this week. They met the Spice Girls. As the Spice Girls said to Nelson, "You're only as old as the girl you're feeling." Their audience with the Pope should be a beauty. And that's the good news.
It's good news week. Someone's dropped a bomb somewhere, contaminating atmosphere and blackening the sky. It's good news week. Someone's found a way to give the rotting dead a will to live, go on and never die. It's good news week.
Thank you, good evening. Tonight, back after a one-week suspension for dangerous riding, the horse frightener Mikey Robbins, the eyes and ears of Canberra, political correspondent Margot Kingston, and a highly fancied runner, especially if the track is wet, Anthony Morgan. And their opponents over 3,000 metres, the mighty and powerful Julie McCrossan, a man who just might be deputy leader of the opposition, the silver-tongued Gareth Evans, and a lady loved by all Australians, especially Kamal, Barry Crocker, and ugly Dave Gray, Amanda Keller. Racing, Mikey, Margot, Anthony, cast your eyes over this.
Looks like a fun party. Rockin'. And he's a small bloke. Ah, right. Bush hitter, mate. That's a bloke with the second biggest sash in Australia. It's hard to get a sash in a big man's size. I've tried. You have to go to Sashes R Us. This guy went to a UN meeting in Melbourne, I believe, and he claimed that he was the exiled prince of Borneo. And the UN went, oh, fair enough. You know, you're like a fat bloke with a sash on, but no, fair enough. And he promised, how much did he promise to give?
About 1.4 million. Billion.
That was a really big scam.
Hey, you're on the opposite team.
Well, you need some help.
You don't do this in question time. You don't say, Alex, ask me about...
I do. But he's silly enough to complain.
Yeah, basically, so this chap got up and said that he was the exiled prince of Borneo. He promised $1.4 billion to the UN. And we find out there's actually a rather sad and deranged Dutchman who lived in Australia, ran out and his seven kids about 14 years ago, and he's a nut.
3 points. No one is quite sure what to make of Prince Haji Mohammed van Eldik of North Borneo, who pledged $1.4 billion to the United Nations this week. Sadly, his billion-dollar donation was in Southeast Asian currency and is worth about $1.35. A UN spokesman denied they had been gullible. And anyway, the money would be easily replaced because the tooth fairy was coming round as soon as they all went nine-eyes. The good news is, Mohammed has now been taken to a special hospital where he's known as the bullshit artist, formerly known as Prince. Julie, Gareth, Amanda, some portentous news for you.
A lot of things. A lot of paper.
Apologies to the pensioners. It's the John Howard's Republic Prevention Strategy. The Constitutional Convention we didn't have to have. But these are the ballot papers, isn't it? The ballot paper for the Constitutional Convention, this impossibly complicated...
Well, it is a reasonably complicated activity.
For a total waste of time.
How many people do you have to vote for accurately in order to have a valid vote? Something like 170, 180?
Oh, ask him. He's a smart one.
Now, you can put a few dots across the top of the line. I think that gets you home. But just put Australian Republican Movement. One. And then you're... Okay.
Oh, hey, Gareth, why don't you just go live in Russia?
Is this going to be soapbox night all night?
That's the break.
Go on, 3 points. Is that right? Well, by now, you've probably all received your Constitutional Convention election kit in the mail. The first person to fill out all their forms correctly, put them in the proper envelopes and return them to the nearest Electoral Commission office will be the President of Australia. Voting at home is supposed to be more convenient, but it took me ages, I mean a long time, to find a really short, blunt pencil that kept breaking. Because when you've got to... You know when you do those ballot things all the time, don't you? It gives you the willies, doesn't it? And you little go into that little box, that little cupboard with your
Paul,
pencil and,
it's
and
not,
you've got... Shut up, Mikey, it's working. They've got to come with me.
Let the joke go, Paul. It's dead.
The good news is the Republicans are trying to create a sense of energy and excitement about this convention. So they've hired Brian Brown to do their commercials. Tonight's Strange But True Clues for Robbins, Kingston and Morgan. A teddy bear. A G rating. And a red bum.
I know it's often the other way, but put it on! Put it on! Put it... The hat with cellulite.
Do your Mick Jagger impersonation.
Jeff Kennett's here.
Good to go, Margot.
No, thanks.
And McCrossan, Evans and Keller received a statue of Buddha.
Possibly a member of the Federal Labor Party, has the girth.
Former member.
An X-ray.
Yeah, here we
are. Magic of television. And the light.
First idea I've had all night, and it was a beauty.
A game called Don't Quote Me to bring in round two. Margot, three statements from a motley crew about the same topic. We want you to tell us what that topic is.
Good. This is one policy I'm happy to have John Howard steal.
One of the things that's been impressive is, for example, what's happened in Sweden.
Well, not while I'm Prime Minister, no.
It's last year... John Howard cut the crap out of anything that concerned anyone on the streets. This year, the all state premiers of all political persuasions convinced Michael Wooldridge and everyone to try something new to solve the heroin problem, the heroin drug trial. John Howard said no, and everyone said, well, hey, John, what are you going to do? And he said, hey, I'll reinstate some programs that I cut last time. So we've got a drug policy that we're all just raving about.
Margot is right. The government has worked out its new policy on drugs. It looks like that's how they worked out a lot of their old policies too. It's good to know government cost-cutting has produced enough cash to fund the customs department back to where it was before government cost-cutting. The drugs policy is worth $87 million, but surprisingly, the street value is considerably less. The Prime Minister compared his tough on drugs campaign with the tough on gun stance of 1996. Does this mean there's going to be a drugs buyback scheme where users can bring in their stash to the local police station and get paid the street value? Gareth, what are these three fine gentlemen referring to?
They can't do that. It's illegal. What he has done is outrageous.
That would be a big mistake.
There's three separate things there, isn't it? Butler's talking about nursing homes, Bill Richardson was talking about native title, and Bill Clinton was talking about a GST.
Rope it in, Gareth! Rope it in and drag it home!
But if it has to be the same thing, what they're really talking about, I think, is the Iraqi government's decision to deny access to US inspectors. Nuclear weapons, chemical weapons, biological weapons, the inspectors have been thrown out. The UN, US is getting very unhappy about it.
Can I just say, Paul, that I think also that Saddam Hussein has threatened to shoot down the spy plane if the UN decide to send the spy plane over there.
No,
so if that's the answer you were looking for, then it came from us. Yeah.
What kind of a smart ass is that over there? That was my question.
Well, you should have answered it thoroughly.
I answered it at nauseous length already.
I did have a bit of a nap in the middle, but I think you're right, so 2 points. It has been a big week for Saddam Hussein. First, he threatened to expel American members of UN weapons inspection teams. Then he threatened to shoot down a US spy plane. And then he threatened to really lose his temper. The inspection team was on the verge of discovering the secret moustache facility that supplied the entire Iraqi army. Although team leader Richard Butler says Saddam got rid of the Yanks because they're about to find his stockpile of a nerve gas, VX, which kills by paralysis. Iraq admits they did have a VX program, but claims they discovered it completely by accident. They're trying to make 4X. which also kills by paralysis. Eventually. The good news is the UN has threatened sanctions if Iraq continues to ignore the UN sanctions. See, they've threatened the sanctions because they're ignoring the sanctions. So if they threaten the sanctions again, they'll probably ignore the sanctions. You've got a sort of an Escher sort of problem there for them. See, because the sanctions have been thus far and the pencil broke and snapped. But the thing is, a game of what next to finish. Amanda, we'll show you a piece of videotape, then freeze it at a crucial moment. All you have to do is tell us what happens next.
Okie doke, I'm ready.
Ha ha!
Oh! Finally, someone who does a worse reverse park than I do.
What happens next? Is it the broken crane crashes onto the dock too? Or is it two men come out of the shed and run for their lives? Or is it three? Greenies in wetsuits push it back into the sea.
They are hopeless on land, aren't they? They're just hopeless. But at least you'll get a disabled parking sticker next time. I think two men come out of the shed and run for their lives, which I would do when I was confronted with our naval power as well, let's face it.
Showing the confidence and defence under the coalition.
That's right. Run!
See, the problem with what you've got to do is you've got a boat on land. It's never going to work.
To this one, Amanda, with due respect to yourself, is a bit easy. I agree with you, it's number two, but after all, every news in the country played it about 17 times.
Oh, well, we won't give you any points then.
It's just that one of those moments where the whole country enjoyed someone's bad luck. Sorry.
Just because the Malaysians wouldn't buy, we didn't have to throw it away, did we?
Only one owner, slight ding, please.
Well, let's see if you're right, even though everyone, of course, knows, according to Julie. On Monday, the synchro lift lowering the $20 million patrol boat broke, leaving it teetering 5 metres above the water. On Tuesday, HMAS Gawler finally made it into Darwin Harbour after the crane broke again. I mean, yeah, come on, let's give these guys lots of guns and let them defend the country. That's a good idea. But if Japanese subs ever sneak into Sydney Harbour again, the Navy could drop a 200-tonne boat on them. This incident poses a lot of questions. Most importantly, what were those two guys doing in the shed? What sort of bozo was running the dock? I mean, even Kate Fisher would have told them, you never drop something worth millions of dollars.
Saucer of cream for Paul.
Anthony, what happens next here?
That guy stands up straight and loses his head.
Now, could it be the soldier dives for cover as gunshots hit the helicopter? Or is it the heartless bastards take off without unloading any food? Or is it rice-crazed villagers wielding machetes attack the chopper?
Actually, I saw this many times on the telly.
That's a Slim Dusty song, number two. The heartless bastards take off without loading any food.
They're all Slim Dusty songs. Rice-crazed villagers
wielding machetes attack the chopper again.
Has it got anything to do with Slim Dusty?
I have no idea.
Okay, if it's New Guinea, well then, they will be delivering food. No one in New Guinea's going to have a gun who would need food.
What about tea?
And why rice-crazed villagers would weld machetes, I've no idea.
Wield.
Why would they wield a machete for?
It's a big machete, Anthony! I think it might be three.
Oh, do you think?
I think it might be three.
We got three.
You're both going three.
We're both going three.
All right. Well, it's my question. I think number two.
All right. You don't want to listen to your team at all on this one?
I think you do.
No, I don't.
I think you
do. No, I don't. A lot of people told me Might and Power would win the Melbourne Cup. And I said,
what I like about you, Anthony, is you don't play to win. You just play for the game.
Oh, great. For two.
Yeah. Let's have a look at it.
Okay, here they are. And here come the villagers with the machetes!
Oh, yeah.
Oh, right, now...
But, and then...
Now, technically, away, who unloaded the food then?
Rice crazed!
Oh, yeah!
Rice crazed villagers unloaded that food!
The harmless bastards didn't touch
I
a
said
sack!
Rice crazed villagers unloaded the food. Yes. With their machetes.
Yeah.
Then the heartless bastards took off.
No.
No, what happened next? What happened next?
We haven't got the next part.
Well, I think that's the most important bit.
Protest. You can't prove we're wrong. You cannot prove we're wrong.
Prove him wrong, monkey boy.
Yeah, come on.
Although, the more I think about it, Margot, the more, as
don't,
I recall...
No, just hold
he doesn't there. Have to prove we're wrong. He can just say we are.
Yep. You're wrong.
It's that kind of show.
About 60 people armed with machetes and sticks rushed to the Australian Black Hawk, which was delivering rice to a drought-stricken village 100 kilometres north of Port Moresby this week. We've got boats that fall over, helicopters that can't defend themselves against starving people with gardening implements. Indonesia, if you're thinking of invading, now's the time. As the Black Hawk landed, hungry villagers were actually shouting, "Bags the big black chicken!" And will you carve or will I? Or maybe the villagers were just incredibly desperate to get some Australian rice. I mean, after
so
all it is...
So desperate that they unloaded it themselves.
sure they are desperate to get some Australian rice because it is, you know, it's high in carbohydrates, it's low in fat, and it molds itself into sculptures, as you talk about. The good news is the Australian crew weren't really worried about the attack. It's a Black Hawk. They felt safer on the ground. Reckless Robinses are on 5 points. And the Mindless Macrossans are on 7 points.
One person to Gareth.
I think I'm going to have to give you an extra point for that. We sort of want one out. Teams, we have Prince Edward, Uda Hussein, Prince Albert of Monaco, and Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Let's face it. I mean, people say cruel things about that man, but he looks good.
Which one?
Schwarzenegger.
I think Uda looks tops.
What's the story with Uda? This is Saddam's son, isn't it? Hasn't he had something terrible happen to his nether regions?
Mm-hmm. They tried to assassinate him, but they only got his most hitherto active part.
Went for his brain down below.
That's right. So maybe there's some sort of procreation thing, because Prince Edward hasn't had children. Prince Albert hasn't had children.
No. Prince Albert looks there like he's just going out for a drink with Prince Edward.
But Udo's the only one that actually totally lacks the tackle. He's got a sort of a Willy Got Freed sort of a problem.
The Prince Edward and Albert,
yeah,
are not inclined to use their tackle in a procreation way.
Whereas Arnold's
a steroid boy, and doesn't your tackle
shrink? No, mate, no, it goes mad, it goes crazy.
Doesn't Mikey?
It's on a separate ski.
Well. About the armed forces, because isn't Uday trying to get into one of the military elite
yes, squads?
Come on, someone run for it!
They've all been soldiers or pretend soldiers except Uday.
Commandos except Albert. Arnie played a commando. Uday was a commando. Prince Edward left the commandos. Albert is the only one who wasn't a commando.
Okay, thank you very much. It is Albert.
Yes.
It is. Good on you. I'm going to give you 3 points. And I'm going to give you 2 points. Schwarzenegger was in the movie Commando. Edward left the Royal Marine Commandos after a dispute over sharing a dressing room. And Uday Hussein, despite being crippled and impotent after an assassination attempt, wants to join the elite Iraqi commandos to kill the hated Americans. But don't American children have enough to fear? First, Russia's nuclear capability makes global destruction possible. Now, flaccid, limping Arabs are after them.
That's a Slim Dusty song, too. Yeah.
Oh, flaccid, limping Arabs are after me. As the US threatened military action, a defiant Saddam Hussein said, "If our hands are cut off, we shall hold the sword in our teeth. And if our chemical weapons leak, we shall hold our teeth in our hands." Robins Renegades are on 9 points. And the Macrossan Mercenaries are on 9 points. The final round, absolute joy. Mikey, Margot, Anthony, your strange but true clues were the teddy bear, G rating, and red bum.
Come on, you actually know this one.
I know this one. I don't know why I know this one, but I do. There was a bit of a kerfuffle in England. People got a bit upset. There's a fella in New Zealand who I think is a thinker. He's a go-ahead sort of bloke. And he's made a video on how to smack your children. How to smack them, I guess, you know, how to smack them without...
Effectively.
Yeah, like...
They've been cruel.
Like the cops do. So that... You know what I mean? So that when child services come around, there's no actual evidence. But in the video, it's got how to hold your child down.
No, why?
While you're smacking them.
Yeah.
Now, I think that's the only bit I don't agree with, because there's nothing more fun than chasing your kid around. Come back here!
Well, it's actually, I'll tell you what, it's just damn good exercise, actually. Instead of aerobics, chasing naughty kitties. They don't have to be your own.
And it's a very...
Just go to a shopping centre and see some kids that are shitting you. Go, come here!
3 points, you are right. Yeah. New Zealand businessman.
Mikey, look. There's a bear in there.
In a chair!
New Zealand businessman Philip Holdway Davis is in a lot of trouble after producing a video in Britain which teaches parents the best way to smack their children. I bet that English nanny, Louise Woodward, wishes she'd had one of these. The good news is there's a companion video for kids called 20 Fun Ways to Injure Daddy. Julie, Gareth, Amanda, your story revolves around the statue of Buddha, the X-ray, and the light.
It's the last 6 months in Canberra. Robert Ray, Colston, boneheaded government. Cheryl shows us the light.
The red flag flying.
There's been research in Britain that has shown that there is actually a God spot in the brain. There's a whole lot of nerve endings that apparently fire electrically, like light up, when they talk about religious experiences.
I talk about Buddha. There are pieces of my brain that start vibrating.
The God spot. It'd be like the G spot. If that was
it?
True, no men would join religion because they can't find it.
Where is it? So you're saying that God is a bundle of nerves?
God is a bundle of nerves in your brain.
But God can't be a bundle of nerves in
Why
your brain.
Why not?
Because God is Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson?
Neither man nor woman, neither black nor white. That's what I've heard.
Now we chase each other around, is that right?
Can people hire you for a function, Gareth?
Cheaply, very cheaply.
You know, British brain research, a point situation.
You are right.
Yes.
Scientists believe they've discovered a God spot in the brain, a circuit of nerves which could explain why some people are more religious than others. So the next time some Mormons come to your door, be nice to them. They've got a nasty growth in their brain. And stress the God spot should not be confused with that part of the brain which causes you to yell out, oh God, yes, yes, oh God, yes, oh God, yes, oh yes, God, the pencil. The scientists have also found the Santa Claus spot, a part of the brain which shrivels up and dies somewhere between the ages of 5 and 7, a part which believes in sharing food with ants, the picnic spot, and a part that causes you to give your dog a really boring name, the spot spot. The good news is ambulance teams will now carry holy electroshock machines. Not to zap your heart, but to tickle your brain. You won't make it, but you'll die believing you're saved. Mikey Robbins, Margot Kingston and Anthony Morgan scored an angelic 12 points. Tying with the transubstantiated Julie McCross and Gareth Evans and Amanda Keller on a righteous 12 points. It's a tie! It's a tie! So we say Mr. Squiggle for president, and at last we can confirm all those rumours. Good News Week is presenting an extra special end-of-year programme from the Enmore Theatre in Sydney on Friday, the 5th of December. But please, no more calls to the ABC. Tickets for the Good News Week special are available through the Enmore Theatre on 9550-3666. For now, we'll leave you with the good news that Australia's Aborigines are taking their fight to the people. The reconciliation process is going to be made into a soap opera, starring Ray Martin as the lovable grandpa, Pauline Hanson as the evil next-door neighbour, and John Howard as the troubled Hamlet-like youth who can't make up his mind about anything. Good night.
Remember, you can catch Paul and Mikey for breakfast, weekday mornings on Triple J.